been wearing it for 2 weeks, and now it's time to talk about it, if our allergies let us. It's the smartwatch that everyone thinks you're wearing, no matter which one you're actually wearing. It's the Apple Watch, and we're giving it the roundtable review treatment. Also, Samsung might be starting to bring its new design language to its tablet line. The first iPhone 6S rumors are trickling out. And is Windows 10 the last version of Windows ever? Well, no. But that's a story for some reason. All that, plus the return of Dial F for Fail on episode 148 of the Pocketnow Weekly, the once-a-week podcast covering news and opinion from the world of mobile technology, tablets, smartphones, wearables, and beyond, all that stuff you wished you had when you were a kid. From Boston, Massachusetts, where the State House is golden and the airport is Logan, I'm Michael Fisher. Joining us on the flight deck, as always, is Chief News Editor Stephen Schenck, coming in from the Garden State. A double New Jersey salute to you, sir.
Howdy, howdy, Michael.
And from South America, where the Instagram photos are destined to be beautiful, no matter what they're taken of, multimedia manager and soon-to-be Apple Watch owner, Jaime Rivera. Welcome back.
Hello, hello. So if this is not the Garden State, then what is it? This is the mountain.
It's whatever you want it to be, brother. That's how we're rolling today. Podcast producer Jules Wang is keeping us on the air with some flair from the WERS studios, and the time in Boston is 12:05 p.m. To you listeners, I say 0110100, 0110100001.
Your winery is amazing.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And as most of you know, if you're a true tech nerd, that's binary for high. And if you didn't know that, you haven't been spending enough time at lynda.com/pocketnow, where you can challenge yourself to learn something new right now with a free 10-day trial. It's used by millions of people around the world. It has over 3,000 courses and topics from web development to photography to visual design to business, as well as software training like Excel, WordPress, and Photoshop. All their courses are taught by experts, and new courses are added to the site every week. So whether you want to take better pictures, make better music, design better products, or talk in binary, for some reason, make 2015 the year you get off your duff and get better at stuff. Visit lynda.com/pocketnow. That's lynda.com/pocketnow. And get on the train.
Man, speaking of binary, did you guys see Joe Belfiore's shirt at Build the other week?
No, what was he wearing?
It was like a Windows logo. It just looked like a normal, you know, window thing. But you zoomed in close, it was all ones and zeros. And of course, people like got high-res stills of this and decoded it. I don't know what it actually said, but there was a hidden binary message in the background there.
How do you bring something up like that and not know what it said? Now I feel
fundamentally unfulfilled. I'm not going to give you the whole story. You can go and figure it out for your...
I don't think you are telling the truth.
Come on, Stephen. You're the one that's supposed to enlighten us, dude.
I was waiting to get this
amazing story right now.
Yeah, I mean, come on. We don't tune in for this. Well, anyway, Stephen, you do know how to tell us something. I have to apparently get some pollen out of my throat. I don't know what's going on. Tell people how things work on this contraption we call a technology podcast, will you?
Well, here's what we like to do is we're going to talk about stuff for a while, and we're going to give you our opinions, and then we're eventually going to get tired of talking or run out of things, and that's where you guys come in. Because if you are watching us live on Google Hangouts, you can use the Q&A tool there to ask us, Qs, and then we will do our best to give the A's. The other viewers can vote up the comments they like the best. We will try to respond to some of the more popular ones, ones that are most germane to the topic at hand. If we do not get to your question, as happens, well, all the time, as we only have so much time to do this show, and we have a lot of questions from you, shoot us an email. We'll do our best to answer it on a future program. But either Q&As or email, we wanted to start hearing from you guys.
Well said, Stephen. And I've been unsuccessful in getting my throat clear.
Have you tried the gravity boots, if you just let it all kind of flow out of you at night?
They appear to be wearing magnetic boots. No, I'm not going to assassinate the Chancellor today, friend. We have some announcements to get through, and I'm going to ask Jules if he has the proper sound drop for that. Jules, will you usher us into announcements, please? Thank you very much, sir. Well, hey, that was pretty good. This is an announcement that I think a lot of people will find very interesting, and I will ask Stephen or Jaime, if you want to read it. I was going to ask Stephen to do it, but you know, we like hearing your voice on the show, and we don't get to hear your voice on the show all that often, which makes a lot of us very sad. So, do you want to tell people what they can win, Mr. Rivera?
You're going to kill me. I thought I was going to win that LG G3.
Well, you are the biggest latent LG G3
fanboy. There was a shipping error filling out folks, the form.
Folks, one of my favorite smartphones has always been an LG-based smartphone, whether it's ever since the G2. It was probably one of the best. And you have a chance to win an LG G3 on this podcast. So, Michael, would you mind telling them exactly what they have to do?
No problem, Jaime. I was hoping that you would make something up so that I wouldn't have to make something up.
We just stole your time at this point.
Yeah, we gave away the when we gave away the VR headsets last round, the G3 VR headsets, we had a wonderful trivia question on this show, and the answer to that trivia question was the film, the mid-90s masterpiece, Virtuosity, starring Russell Crowe and Denzel Washington. And I don't have a trivia question this week. We're going to do this a little bit differently. I was looking...
I don't know the answer to it, but if we're going with the whole Virtuosity mid-90s thing, what was the size of Johnny Mnemonic's memory capacity? Johnny Mnemonic.
You should
tell me nothing. I'm sure our phones have more. Maybe not.
Yeah.
Is that like the biggest flop movie of all time, by the way?
No.
What, Johnny Mnemonic?
No, yeah. but
there
it's
are far worse movies.
Probably on the list somewhere. actually, there is no trivia question. If you want to tell us what the answer to that is, please write us at podcast@pocketnow.com.
We're curious.
And if you want to tell us any other ridiculous trivia about 90s tech movies, I'm kind of into that. But no, this is actually much more straightforward. We did this once before.
Mm-hmm.
If you want your chance to win this device, I was on iTunes the other day. I was on this application I have on my MacBook. And I was like, man, I'm going to see what the Pocketnow Weekly podcast looks like on the iTunes search page. And, you know, it looks pretty good. We've got a lot of reviews, and they're all pretty universally wonderful. Which is great, and thank you all for those. But we need more, because this podcast audience is, you guys are all outstanding, but you also have maintained a steady number for far too long. We want to grow this show a little bit more. And as awesome as Jules' graphics on the screen are at all the time, they're not going to do it alone. So we need you to review the show. If you wanted a chance to win this LG G3 smartphone, please give us a review on iTunes. I'm not saying it has to be a, what's it called? A positive review. That would be probably illegal, I think, in some way, or at least against the terms and conditions of iTunes. So give us your honest review, please. And iTunes, the reason we asked you to do it on iTunes is because it is the most popular destination for podcasts that also maintains a reviews structure. So leave a review, and we will examine all the reviews left after the contest start date, which, Stephen, correct me if I'm wrong, was Monday, right?
Isn't that a different contest?
No, I mean not the G3 giveaway. How we're giving them away on the site too, right?
Yeah. We got one on the site. We're doing that started on Monday.
Yeah, so we're going to look for all the reviews that were posted after Monday. If you've already left an iTunes review, thank you very much. Send us a screenshot of your old review. Say you are still totally eligible for this giveaway. Send it to Stephen. What is it? Contests@pocketnow.com?
Contest, I believe. I should
contest singular at pocketnow.com, or send a screenshot of your new review to contest@pocketnow.com. We will choose one randomly and send you an LG G3. These are AT&T units, but this is, Stephen, a global giveaway?
Yes, it is.
Open to
You're going to have to unlock it yourself, but it's
going to be planet Earth. Yeah, but you can unlock it yourself if you need to. Or you can use it on AT&T, which is a wonderful carrier as well. So, all that being said, I'm sure there will be questions. Drop them in the Q&A if you have them, folks. But we got to get to the news. Am I right, Jules? Bring us into the news. He wasn't ready.
Nope, choose not to.
I like this pacing, Jules. You like it? It's tight.
This is CNN.
Five-time Emmy-winning newscaster Jaime Rivera of the Pocketnow Daily.
Oh, God.
I want to get back to that crossfire thing we had going last week, shouting over each other about stupid Engage platform.
Yeah, shouting past each other. I'm going to get my bow tie on, and we're going to get Tucker Carlson on the show, and we're going to reach a new level of discourse.
Outstanding.
Folks, we have news about Windows 10 that's not really news about Windows 10, and Stephen, I will eagerly await your efforts to make this somehow swallowable. Because this seems like the biggest bullshit news story I've seen this week. I saw it run by other sites.
There were more. There were more. Trust me.
Yeah, I just like And kudos to you, Stephen, for not going for the easy headline, which was of course some variation of Windows 10 will be the last version of Windows ever.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay. I went like this. I saw it on Twitter, and I was like, okay, I have to click on this. You know I have to click on this, and you know it doesn't mean what you are saying, implying that it means. And I hate you for successfully clickbaiting me.
Yeah, you see that, and you think, okay, Microsoft's going to release Windows 10 in the fall, and that's it. They're going to pack up shop. They're going to go, it's just going to be Xbox One from here on out. We're done with this whole Windows scene. Played out.
Over, yeah. Man. It's like that old Onion story. Like, Dell reaches goal of being top computer supplier in the world, shuts down.
It's like, didn't it do that, though?
Yeah, pretty much, actually.
The Onion.
Yeah. Well, how this all got started is we have a comment from a Microsoft employee referring to Windows 10 as the last version of Windows. And there's some truth in that, because Windows 10 isn't just the next version of the operating system. It's not just the Windows 7 or Windows 8. Microsoft, as we've known for a while now, has much grander ambitions, and Windows 10, beyond just spreading across form factors, is also intended to be this Windows as a service idea going forward. It's just going to be Windows from here on out. Yes, 10's the number it's arriving with, but then they're going to build on 10 with new features. The framework is there for Microsoft to keep delivering updates, to tweak things. It's not going to be static. It's not going to be the Windows 10 that we get this fall is what we're going to be dealing with for the next decade to come. It's going to evolve as operating systems do. I like to look at it like OS X. Apple's been doing OS X for friggin' ever now. There's always new versions of it. There's plenty of animals to name things after. And there might be smaller little decimal iterations along the way, but Windows 10 is going to be the banner under which we'll be referring to Windows for a long time to come. I don't know that the forever thing is set in stone. I can see Microsoft changing course, 5-6 years down the line here. But for the foreseeable future, it's Windows 10, Windows 10, Windows 10.
So basically, what I was thinking it was non news.
Mm-hmm. So basically, it's going to be another OS 10, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I mean, I don't think that's what I said, Jaime. But if you want to get the angry emails for a statement like that, you are free to field them.
I'm already used to them.
I know you've got the thick skin grown already.
And it's just funny. I mean, by the way, Stephen, the way Apple usually dubs it is OS 10, not OS X. So yeah,
it's just write OS the word 10 then.
I know, dude. I know. I feel exactly the same way. But it's like, okay, OS X, Windows 10, OS 10, Windows 10.
That made me think. That sentiment made me think of Stephen being the sort of resident old man of the podcast, followed by me, who's been accused of being a grumpy old man since I was 10. Which made me think of an experience I had yesterday, which is not related to anything on the damn rundown. But I was going to rehearsal for the show I'm doing, and I had like 10 minutes, and I saw just at that moment that Taylor Martin was periscoping something.
I remember that guy.
Yeah, remember that fella?
Ooh.
And I was like, all right, I'm going to take a break from being mad at you for 2 minutes, and I'm going to look at this periscope. And that turned into a 17-minute enjoyable time. Have you guys used Periscope yet?
What the hell is Periscope?
Okay. I hate it.
I hate it. Stephen doesn't know what it is. And
it's
about
Meerkat, right? I know them in the same breath. I know I don't
need like
them.
It's like Meerkat, pretty much. The problem is, I don't know. I can't like really select what I want to watch because it's either you watch it live or you don't.
So YouTube for people who aren't using YouTube.
Immediate. It's immediate. It's simple to set up. You just start periscoping, and then
it
auto-posts to Twitter the link, and then people can join it. And people can instantly feedback with comments like as the stream is going on, and you can answer them via voiceover or just direct to camera as the thing is going on. So that's what I did yesterday. I just kind of like dropped a bunch of questions and comments in the feed while Taylor was periscoping.
Not
was
at all trolling him.
I was trolling him a little bit initially, but then I was like, this is actually too cool for me to just be a jerk because this is... Now, and importantly, I think the novelty did wear off rather quickly because he was uploading a video and he was just periscoping the process of uploading the video.
Jesus, this is like watching paint dry.
Right, a bit, except it's, it's him and his girlfriend and their dog in the room, so the dog would walk by and the dog had a diaper on it because the dog was menstruating or something like that. I don't know, some shit was going on.
Dogs are won't.
do. But this is the kind of stuff that, like, this is all the kind of stuff that we normally edit out in a professional style video, but it's just raw. It's just straight up. It's like it happened, and that's appealing to a degree. So we weren't able to do this. I've wanted to Periscope a podcast setup session before, but at the WERS studios, there's no signal. There's no cell signal underground there, so I can't.
Do they not have Wi-Fi?
Yeah.
And Jules is saying ample Wi-Fi right there.
Yeah, I know. And
don't have the credentials.
Saying, I'm gonna address this right now, actually, from Christopher Creveling in the Q&A. Totally dig the new lower thirds and Jules' ticker news. Jules, your ticker news is really awesome. But how come, Michael, you're not in the studio anymore? Yeah, I haven't been in the radio studio for like the past two or three podcast guys, and it's mainly been a scheduling thing, but we've received a lot of feedback from you saying that, hey, the podcast works better when you're not in the studio.
It kind of does. I can't fault that.
And whether that's a function of me not using various USB hubs to connect to the various pieces of equipment in the studio, whether it's a function of my office internet working better than the studio internet, I don't know. But if this continues, I mean, it got to be a real headache there.
Let's just drop some chroma key green on top of your foam noise insulation back there and just put the studio background
just put
in.
The WERS studio vibe, yeah.
There you
and
go.
I wanted to say, it's not...
I'll bring the green screen.
Jules has maintained this forever. It's my MacBook's fault, and I'm loath to disagree, but we are so far off track. I just wanted to answer that question and to say that I Periscoped, y'all, and if you have a cool Periscope coming up, let me know about it. Maybe I'll watch because I'm kind of into it now.
So do people not do Vine anymore? Is that dead?
I feel Vine is, I don't know.
Vine is still there. Vine is still there. It's still around, but
it's just not hot anymore, you know? I don't know. I wanted to talk about how Secret shut down, but we didn't report on it, and now it's too late. So
Vine is the home for the cheesiest, funniest, for the cheesiest video you can look at. I mean, I don't know. They try to be comedians, but they're not.
Jaime, do you Vine?
No, thank you.
We should all Vine.
Let's keep talking about Windows.
That's the Windows fans are gonna mutiny and bludgeon us over the head. Microsoft prepares for a new preview version of Windows 10 for phones later this week. I want to know what's going to be included in it. Jaime, this was your story. Tell me what I can expect on my Lumia 830 or other device.
Well, that's the thing. We've been waiting for build 1008. How do you say that? That's 10080. That's 10,080.
Sexiest code names ever, right?
I know, exactly. But we've been waiting for this build since last week. Microsoft hadn't really promised it, but it was gearing up to launch it to the Microsoft Insider build. And what you're getting is, well, you're getting a slider for live tile transparency in the background. But the coolest thing is that you're finally getting Office as a universal application for Windows 10. We've seen a couple of leaks. We thought at the beginning that it was only going to be Word and PowerPoint, but then we saw some separate leaks of Excel, and working pretty much the way we see it work on other platforms like iOS. So it's really the fact that this is finally arriving to Windows 10. The problem is that it is currently being tested by Microsoft's inner circle, which they call the ring. So there is no guarantee that you're getting it this week. There's just that promise that if everything goes well, you'll get it. And the coolest thing is that the Lumia 930 and Lumia Icon are finally included on the list.
Cool. Damn, so we have these modern smartphones that run Windows, and now we can finally use them to test out the preview. Now, I still don't know if I'd recommend that, Jaime.
No, neither do I.
It runs pretty poorly still, and I don't mean to say that should be a surprise. We've maintained from the start that it's a preview build. We get ready for preview performance, but
you can always play with it and then go back to 8.1.
That's a good point. And if you want to be part of the solution rather than just complaining and whining like
rabble,
I do,
rabble.
You can write down a list of the things you'd like and don't like and submit them to Microsoft, and Microsoft will use your feedback in its future design of Windows 10 for phones. So you should do it. I'm just saying that the more I use the technical preview, the more I'm like, no, I just want to wait for the full release, because the more I use the technical preview, I think the less I like Windows.
Yeah, and you and I have the option of going back to another phone. Like if this is your only phone, like that Lumia 830 or 930 is your only device, I would not recommend you.
Definitely.
You no, definitely not right. But if you have an extra Windows phone out there, you want to go buy one of the which is the $100
get like a $50
model?
535 or yeah, something. Put
exactly.
You want it.
Exactly. And put the preview on that. But don't do it on your daily driver because it is just gonna you're gonna hate it. And it's not worth. I feel that there is a lot of good coming to the Windows 10 build for phones, but we don't want you to hate it so early.
We have this question was going to come up sooner rather than later. Do you guys feel that Windows Phone along with BlackBerry is a niche market? Asks Happy Pills. I don't see a benefit to use a Windows device over iOS or Android, even if the cameras are better, not by much. App support and OS fluidity are better on other platforms. All right, I'm going to go halvesies with you, Happy Pills. I think that app support, no one will contest your app support point. The ecosystems are much stronger on iOS and Android. OS fluidity, though, your point is not valid, I am going to say, because Windows Phone tends to run exceedingly smoothly no matter what hardware it's running on, and that is has sort of been the truth for years and mo years. So I'll give you your ecosystem point. But is it a niche market? Yeah. I mean, Stephen, Jaime, all we've seen the past year is Microsoft not releasing a high-end device. We talk about it almost every week. You know, kind of putting off the flagship until the Windows 10 days, and as a result, it's just becoming the world's least visible operating system. I feel like I see even more BlackBerry buzz in my Twitter feed than I do Windows Phone these days.
No, and I think what he means with app fluidity is like going into the Spotify application. Every time you go into it, the app reloads fully from scratch. So I think that's what he means with fluidity on the operating system.
Okay, so multitasking response time
is terrible.
Yeah. But there's a flip side to that too, because every modern Android phone I've used, and I've used them all the ones that are going to be available for stateside retail this season, have major memory management problems. That 5.1.
Thanks, Lollipop.
Yeah, Lollipop.
5.1 has sort of corrected, but Lollipop brings with it a host of other issues like the notification stuff and a lot of other complaints that Joe Levi is writing up in a piece in an Android M wishlist us, I think, today. So, you know, it's always a trade-off. So if the ecosystem is not as big a point, I still think Windows Phone is a great place to be. The more interesting question right now, I think, is whether Windows 10 is going to make that more true or less true when it comes to phones. And we won't know that for a little while yet.
Months and months.
Yeah, which is another part of the problem, but let's just be happy we're going to get another preview build. And I think Jules was flashing up a tweet from Gabe All, that is how you say his last name, right? At Microsoft, saying that we should expect this, in fact, sooner rather than later. So it may land by the end of the week. If it does, I'll be in Virginia, so I won't be able to do a video. I'm sorry, everybody. I have to go be in a bawdy comedy show, which will be fun. And yeah, that'll be fun. Not burlesque, but a bawdy show nonetheless.
Let us know when you get back from the 1920s.
No problem. Hey, I might have to grow a pencil thin mustache for the show I'm doing. I'm looking forward to it if I do.
That takes
What's
you
next?
Like 2 days.
Yeah. Well, you know. Could these be the first pictures of the Galaxy S6 Active? We're transitioning.
Maybe.
Samsung.
Yuck.
So, Rhythmic Row was reporting on this. This is a leak from, I think, GSM Arena is our source on this. A follow-on to last year's Galaxy S5 Active. The Galaxy S6 Active would appear to be a more rugged, possibly, probably waterproof.
This looks like
version.
A Cassioca Zone or something.
Yeah, it definitely looks like an intense tank of a handset. This is it actually looks very much like the S5 Active, except it doesn't seem to have a camo paint job in this leak, which is interesting.
Christ.
But let's talk about the specs. You know, it's obviously beefy and tanky and really ugly. The source mentions a 35... All right, there's a typo there. 35,000 milliamp hour battery. A 3,500 milliamp hour battery, which would be a... almost a 1,000 milliamp hour improvement over the standard S6. Likely non-removable, which is interesting because that back door looks like it comes off on this tank, but maybe that's just aesthetics. What else? Just a model number, SMG890A, and then the Exynos 7420, same 5.1-inch QHD Super AMOLED display.
Previous actually heard some pretty compelling rumors about this guy. I think it mentioned possibly micro SD coming back, but I don't see anything about that here.
That would be interesting. Now, why would you, like, this phone is built for people to beat up and to drop and everything. Why would you want to introduce another component that could fail?
What is the one argument you hear every time people talk about why they're dropping micro SD support? Because we want to make the phone super sleek and it would add an imperceptible millimeter here or there or a little crease in the exterior. Well, this thing is already bulky and not too attractive, so what do you have to lose?
Indeed. I mean, you are making a solid point, but with a phone like this that's meant for people to kick it around and like drop it off porches and throw it into their beer, like, why do you want to introduce another casing penetration in the form of a micro SD card slot that could needs another gasket, needs another, you know, sector of the certification? And I don't know. If there is a slot here, I guarantee you I will find a way to get water into it and destroy the phone.
What would be the problem of making the most horrible phone I've ever seen any more horrible with an extra gasket?
Yeah, it's your point is well taken. It's not attractive. But let me ask you, we're seeing the...
Not old... attractive? Come on, dude.
Maybe that's so charitable, nice. Right? Yeah, I know.
Come on.
But let me ask you a question. We're seeing the all-black version leaked here with the AT&T logo silkscreened on it, so maybe like the S5 Active, it'll be an AT&T exclusive in the States. What if the color scheme was different? What if they did something interesting like a navy border around the sides and like a blue-gray like back cover?
What you want is that military-type back cover of the S5.
Like the camo? Yeah. Yeah, but I don't want the woodland jungle camo from like Vietnam era. I want the digital navy camo that the Coast Guard wears. That would be cool.
Seriously.
Yeah.
I think that cover was stuck in the Vietnam days, dude.
It was.
At least Desert Storm. Something like that.
Oh, Jules is reminding us of the S4 Active on the screen right now. Well, he was a second ago. And that thing had a nice... Remember that brilliant blue reflective paint job that thing had?
Dude, cool. I mean, the S4 Active was actually a better looking phone than the S4.
Yeah, it actually was. I thought so, too. Even though, like, it was ugly, too. I don't want to say that it wasn't ugly, because it was ugly, too, but it was ugly in the way that people who, this is going to sound terrible, but like, so like, you know when you're having a rough day and you know you don't look good, but you own it, you know what I mean? You go out on the town, you're like, your hair's all screwy and you got the face grease going on, you haven't showered in a few days, but people are looking at you and are like, I don't care, I'm just being me, I'm just trying to get by, why don't you leave me alone? That's what the S4 Active was doing.
Like, I don't relate to that part of you haven't showered in a few days.
No? You never been... Well, I guess, yeah. Well, I'm thinking of college, maybe.
Before we move on, there's one other component to this thing that...
Yeah, what?
Like, since we went to press with this, the FCC docs for the S6 Active have apparently popped up.
So nice.
So looking at the timetable that means about that, but it looks like it's still happening. I don't know if the bands are, like, there, if it confirms AT&T or not, but I will look into that.
This sucker is going to be, it's going to drop like secret-like. Like, we're just going to get a press release one morning that says it's in stores, and then we'll ask for one, and then these are the most fun to test out, and I'm looking forward to doing it.
destroying phones.
No, and I actually don't. I actually hate destroying phones. We got did you guys see that Unbox Therapy video where he shoots the Galaxy S6 Edge with a Desert Eagle pistol? So it's like a D-brand sponsored video, and they shoot, and it's beautifully shot.
It's like a OnePlus thing.
Yeah, right. It does, doesn't it?
Get a new one.
Like it's beautifully shot in 4K with like an absurd frame rate that lets you see all the mechanical action of the gun going off and the casing being ejected and stuff. And then you see the bullet hit the D-brand skin on the outside of the S6 Edge, and you know bounce off, and the phone is fine. No, I'm kidding. The bullet, of course, goes through the phone and destroys it completely. And it's horrible. It's terrible to watch. I mean, it's a gorgeous, a beautifully shot video. He's a very talented YouTuber. But holy shit, man, stop. And, you know, I understand that, you know, there's a whole industry built around destruction porn of gadgets. But, and I think this was probably D-Brand's idea. But, like, I'm just, no, I don't want to.
Oh,
I don't want any part in this. That's terrible. I hate watching that. I don't know. It just makes me so sad. I'm not saying it shouldn't be done. I'm just saying it personally makes me sad to watch gadgets just get obliterated for no good reason.
I was thinking about this. I was looking through a catalog of AV hardware, looking at all the nice microphones in there, and thinking about, you know, how people will drop the mic when they go off stage. They rely on the microphone. That's like that's how they do their art there. Why would you disrespect it like that?
It breaks my heart to see those stars smashing their perfectly good guitars.
Oh,
what I'm saying, yeah,
tears me up.
Great song.
I'd rather give the phone away.
Yeah, me too. And actually, I'm not even saying that because that's usually the complaint with when people do a drop test video. It's like you could have given that phone away, and it would have, you know, it's like, oh man, I would have taken it.
We're learning something from that.
Right, exactly.
This with is the drop not, test, you're like, you know, it's gonna shoot right through the phone.
Right. And again, beautifully shot video, very talented guy. The channel has a lot to offer. Nothing personal. I just hate it. Hate it.
I'm trying to remember this video where it was like, I think it was iPhone 5S versus 44 Magnum.
Yeah,
it's like, right. I'm like, why do you do this if you know that the 44 Magnum is going to pretty much wipe the phone off the face of the camera? It's like, what's the point? You know what's going to win.
While we're talking about, just before we move off the S6 Active, I just want to make the point that I think it makes a lot more sense. It makes a lot more sense than the S5 Active did, because the S5 Active was the active version of a phone that was already waterproof and already pretty, like, you know, it wasn't impact resistant. It wasn't rated to be impact resistant, but it was a phone you didn't feel bad about throwing around.
There's a reason for this.
This is exactly. This makes a lot of sense, because the regular S6, I decided that I'm going to use the S6 Edge this weekend it doesn't matter why. And it's a beautiful glass slab, but it also feels very fragile, and it's not at all waterproof, or at least it's not rated to be. So the S6 Active has a really great reason to exist, and I'm looking forward to trying it out.
It's just amazing how Sony is able to figure that out, and then every other company can. How to make a beautiful phone. Sony's able to make a beautiful waterproof phone, and nobody else can.
Right.
Have we tried any of the new Sonys with the waterproof ports that don't need the covers on them?
Is the Z3 one of them?
No.
I don't think, no, the Z3 is not,
no.
But there was a lower end model since then.
No.
Tell us about, let's stay with Samsung and let's talk about tablets, because I understand the Galaxy S6 design language might be moving to a larger format, Stephen Schenck.
Yeah, we've been hearing about this Galaxy Tab S2 for a while now. It's going to be a pretty big departure from Samsung's tablets to date, in that it's going to be the first that embraces this 4:3 aspect ratio, most popular from the iPad. It's cropped up in the Nexus 9 and the NVIDIA tablet, and now it looks like Samsung is joining that club as well. And unsurprisingly, it looks a lot like the latest Samsung smartphones. We saw some of the first renders of the device to leak this week. It's got, well, they got that big home button down there. They're sticking with it. It does go with a little bit of a metallicized edge. It reminds me a lot of the Galaxy Alpha a bit.
Yeah, one of my favorite Samsung phones ever. Sorry.
Yeah, and as the Tab S becoming back with an OLED display, making it like the most premium of Samsung's tablet offerings. We've heard about, I think, two different sizes, both with the 4:3 aspect and both with 2K class screens, 20-something by 15-something, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Still not a great sense of when this guy's going to launch, though, but hopefully soon.
Okay. All right. Anything else we need to be excited about this? I feel like I haven't touched a Samsung tablet in a while. I'm sorry, did you mention is there any word of any Note variant of this, or we're going to have to wait for the new Note to see where that design language is going to go with their next round of tablets?
I don't recall hearing anything about stylus support, but I may not be up on this guy.
Yeah. That still continues to excite me more than the tabs or the large Note.
Everything. Why can't there be an OLED version of the tablet that's also has the S Pen and all the good stuff all in one? That Samsung.
Indeed. And without a software layer that lags. I think this might be the year, actually.
Dare to dream.
Yeah, well, I wasn't planning on saying this, but I actually think this is probably the year where if Samsung brings some tablets to IFA, as it has historically done in the past, despite its stated intention to slim down its product offerings, if it brings tablets to IFA this year alongside the new Note handheld, I think this will be the year that the software is actually really, really responsive on the tablet, because they've demonstrated an ability to do it on the phones now.
Well, but that's the thing. They've done it on the Galaxy. I sent this video to Steven a few days ago, which had Hugo Barra, which used to work for Google, now works for Xiaomi. Guy was giving Hugo Barra. That's the way it's pronounced.
I know. It's great. It's terrific.
So the guy was being asked, why do their flagship phones not have SD cards?
Because they hate their users.
They hate their users, one, and two, he was making a point over how it makes performance sluggish on phones.
Yes.
And how it doesn't matter how much you couple high-performance processors and graphics, GPUs and everything, if the SD card is going to slow things down. And so he was making a point over why they're not supporting it on flagships. And only on mid-tiered phones that obviously you have a slow processor, the SD card is not going to make a difference anyways. And so that is the biggest question. The Samsung Galaxy S6 surely has the boost in performance that we've been waiting for, but it doesn't have a micro SD card slot. So the question is this going to be what happens with the Note lineup going forward, in the sake of giving us better performing Note phones and Note tablets?
I am looking forward to the answer to that question, and I don't know what it's going
to
be.
You're not running the system software off the micro SD card. It augments it. I don't get what that objection's about.
I agree. Ever since what version of Android that you couldn't even install certain things on SD cards anymore? You could only put music on it and videos.
That's all I want to do. Keep my media on it.
Right.
I don't think it's too much to ask.
I feel like we had a long version of this conversation
last week, didn't we?
Yeah, let's press onward in the interim. I wanted to share with you all my most sad moment of the week, which was this. I read a headline on Pocketnow.com that said, new Moto X camera upgrades could include arrival of OIS. And I read it.
Sounds good. But you thought they're talking about a new version of the current Moto X?
Yeah, I read it like Moto X camera upgrades could include arrival of OIS. But really how I should have read it was
New Moto X
camera upgrades
could arrival. Sorry to burst your bubble.
Yeah, so that's the thing. This is not concerning the existing Moto X, but the new one, right, Steven?
Next Moto X. We have had high expectations for Moto X cameras since the get-go. They're talking about the clear pixel, extra white pixels in there that are...
The clear pixels which sucked luminance on the previous Moto X, yes, of course.
It's supposed to give us great low-light performance, and didn't really happen. And then we had the 2014 Moto X, and higher resolution, and it's still kind of let us down, but maybe the 2015 version will come through with optical image stabilization and another resolution bump and the clear pixel again, and I'm not going to hold my breath knowing Motorola's
Don't remind me. I almost died this weekend. I actually fulfilled the bucket list dream of going to the concert that I've always wanted to go to in the city that I always wanted that concert to happen.
One Direction?
You went...
Steven, I said a bucket list dream, dude.
You went to go see Journey in the North Dakota Hippodrome?
Okay, so that it would have been up there, like really up there. But it's a Guatemalan guy who became famous outside of Guatemala, and he comes back to his country for the concert. And so I was there, but the problem is it was going to rain. The weather forecast said it was going to rain, so I was like, crap, I'm going to have to take the Moto X. So I was like, okay, fine, I'll take the Moto X, and, it does a decent job in daylight, but I had never taken low-light photos with it. My God.
Where is this going?
Yeah. My God. I was going to die. I was going to die. And it didn't rain, so I could not take good memories of that moment because of the Moto X.
This is my thing. I'm in the same boat as you, except I'm on the front side of it. Like, I had to decide on what phone I was going to take on my weekend, to Virginia, and I was like, well, I'm going to be hanging out at night with a lot of people. I need a good low light shooter. All I wanted to do was take my Moto X. For the last 2 months, all I wanted to do is move back into that phone because that's my phone. I miss it And yeah. I'm not going to bother with the 1020 right now because of various other things. So, wow, I really want to be able to use the Moto X. Oh, wait, the camera sucks, and I'm going to be taking 80% of my pictures in low light. I can't use that phone.
I can't use the Nexus 6 either.
What's that?
You guys seem like you're taking pictures constantly.
You gotta preserve those moments, brother. Mm-hmm. They ain't gonna last in your memory forever.
No, you made a point at the beginning of the podcast, Michael. It's like, this is a place where you would love taking photography, and you just can't. You know, in this day and age, really, every OEM needs to do something. I mean, Samsung is really trashing everybody with their cameras since the Galaxy Note 4. LG just did it with the G4. And, like, really, they've set the bar, and every other OEM needs to follow the same path. It is not the time anymore for excuses with camera quality.
That is the case. You are right. Now that the G4, like, when Samsung did it with the Note 4, I was, you know, it was kind of like, okay, well, this is your super high-end phone. It better have a great camera. And then they followed suit on the S6, and then, you know, suddenly we could rank Samsung up there with, you know, with Sony itself in some respect. But now that the G4 has got it, and, yeah. It'll be interesting to see how Microsoft counters with that.
Care.
What'd you say?
We may have these strong opinions about, you know, having access to all these phones, and we're going to pick and choose which one we want to use as the best image quality. I'm saying shoppers out there, they are not turning down the Moto X because the camera is less than par. There is a camera on it. That's all they care about.
I disagree. I think shoppers are not picking the Moto X for a variety of reasons, but the biggest one among them is that nobody seems to know it exists. I don't think it's advertised. But I think it's improper to say that people don't care about camera quality. I think they do. It's one of the first things I get asked when people are like, "Oh, what phone is that? How many megapixels it got?" You know, I'm like, "Okay, well, that's not the conversation I want to have." But I understand that you want to know how good the camera.
This is what they care about.
Yeah. So I think it's all deceptive advertising and marketing, Stephen. I think you're right, but. I do think people care about the quality. Tell us. Sound off. Speaking of sounding off, everybody in the Q&A, thank you for all of your questions. Make sure that they're focused on the Apple Watch because we're opening up the questions on the Apple Watch in the next segment, and we need to talk about that. But keep sending them in regardless in the Q&A right now if you're listening live. What's the next thing? Hey, Stephen wrote a damn review.
Yeah, it happens.
When was the last time you wrote a review, Stephen? Do you remember?
Oh, it was some awful tablet. It was one of the first 1080p models.
Oh, the Acer. This Acer tablet.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah.
Really?
It was not great. Well, it was like 4 years ago.
Go ahead, Jaime.
I am really envious of that LiveScribe review.
Yeah, so you finally got to review something, Stephen, that is in line with your particular lifestyle of old-school delightfulness. Hold it up again. Indeed. Show everybody what you reviewed again. This is the LiveScribe Android Pen, which, wow, that is a cigar. That ain't no...
It is a chunky boy.
Monster pen. And it's a pen. Tell our listeners who can't see what you're holding up, tell everybody in 200 words or less what the hell it is.
LiveScribe 3 is a Bluetooth-connected pen. It is a physical ballpoint pen. You can write on it any notebook. But when you use the special LiveScribe digital paper, it's got a little camera in here, and it records all of your pen strokes. Then you sync it to your phone or tablet, supports iOS and now Android with the new update, and it gives you a digital copy of what you wrote. It can do OCR, convert your written word to text, and let you share it with people nice and easily.
So why do I want to do that, Stephen? What is the use case for this? What if I mean, this is for people who want to write things down on paper, have an ink copy, but have a digital backup. Is that the idea?
Yeah, I mean, how often, well, maybe not too often for you, but let's say you're taking notes on something. Is it easier for you to be typing things away on your laptop, to try to be, you know, hunting and pecking on your tiny on-screen virtual keyboard, or just jotting things down on a nice big sheet of paper? And if you're doing that, often you have to come back to the paper, transcribe things, go through your notes. This way you already have that digital copy. The OCR is pretty decent, especially if you have better handwriting than mine. So you already have a text copy you can attach to email, or just send the PDF of the picture of it. It can also, it's a neat thing where it will record your strokes as you're writing, so it's sort of like a playback in real time with audio annotations. There's no mic built into this pen. There are for some other live scribes. So you have to have your phone or tablet nearby to rely on its mic. Then you can take that whole package and it's assembled as a PDF, so you can easily send it to someone and they can see, you know, you can talk about what you're writing as you write it down, so you get a little presentation thing. So I can see uses for businesses, especially at meetings. This is a great way to keep track of what happened. Students, it's a lot easier to whip this out in class than a big laptop, especially if you don't have a nice solid surface in front of you. So I can see a lot of flexible use cases for this.
I was going to ask you about that, but you answered my question already. We actually reviewed the original Smart Pen in 2007.
Yeah, I was going to make that. Like, I don't want to put super old.
No, I actually got that pen for Brandon's brother, for Jared Miniman, back in the day. I got it for review. And, you know, the coolest thing that I found about that pen was, like, you're writing things down, and whenever you would tap that specific point in the future where you wrote that piece of in that specific portion of the paper, it would start playing back the audio of what was being said around you during the time that you were writing, but now you tell me that this one doesn't have a microphone. That was, like, the coolest feature of the old one.
I think the best thing about this is the built-in memory, because I had the Bluetooth connection to my tablet was a little hit and miss. It was hard to get it to recognize when the pen was connected, but you don't have to worry about that at all, because there's, I don't know exactly how much flash storage is on here, but as long as it's turned on, and it has to be to write, because turning it on makes the point come out, as long as it's turned on, it's going to remember what you were writing. So even if you don't sync it up with your tablet for the next day or two, it's all stored there right on the pen. So
is that
one less thing to carry around?
Is that a little servo motor that I'm hearing extending the tip there, or is that a sound effect?
No, it's physical. It beeps to let you know it's turning on.
Okay. Oh, and it's a physical twist to extend the tip like
yeah, an extensive just a little pen. Cylinder in the middle here, your turn.
Now, speaking of expensive, how much is this thing?
This guy is the base model. It's $150. You can get it on Amazon for as little as $125. And there's a pro model, which is pretty much the same capabilities hardware-wise. It has darker metal accents. It comes with an extra tip. It comes with extra notebook, couple extra notebooks.
I was going to ask you, what's the price of the paper? Because back when we originally reviewed it, that was the biggest point. Yeah, the pen wasn't that expensive, but the paper was.
This was
and without the paper, it was useless.
It's like the printer and printer cartridge model.
Razor and the blade. I was worried about this going into it, and was all worried, ready for it to be super expensive and to just ruin the whole experience. And admittedly, if you buy right from the manufacturer, it's a little pricey. Looking at the notebooks, because there's a lot of different options here. You can plain sheets, little flip pads, but a regular college-ruled 100-page notebook. They were selling 4 packs for $25, which sounds super expensive to me. Amazon had the same thing for $17, and that seemed expensive, but I was trying to compare it, and like a normal Mead, like a brand name spiral notebook, was $4. So 16 for 4, 17 for 4 for these digital ones, it's not a big premium.
I was about to say it's not that bad.
You factor in though that recurring cost and the added complexity of the thing, and I've got to ask, like, why not just drop the money on a subsidized, like we were talking about before, a Galaxy Note 4 that has a built-in stylus and lets you draw right on the screen.
It's
you don't have to worry about anything.
So much easier to write on paper
because
on the note screen.
That's true.
It still sucks to write on the note screen, dude.
Yeah.
No matter what they do.
I have to point out, you don't have to buy paper for this thing. LiveScribe has PDFs you can download, high-res scans of the special little dot pattern. You have access to a 600 DPI printer. You can print your own paper for this thing.
So, all right. So to get my ballpoint pen with a camera and Bluetooth module in it to read what I'm writing and transfer it to the associated tablet or computer, I'm going to download a PDF, print it out in the physical world, write it so that it can again be digitized. If I do that, Stephen, I feel like I'm going to be trapped in a never-ending logic loop, a causality reality problem. And I'm just never going to escape. I don't know.
You just sounded like the Merovingian, man.
Persephone, what is this? Anyway. Stephen, thank you for that. It is a fascinating little product, and actually, I did think of a use that I might have for it as you were speaking, because the last thing that I do in my life that is a traditional pen and ink is making notes on scripts, because I prefer that to the digital solution. So it would be fun to digitize that on occasion. So thank you. That is the what is it? The Light Scribe.
Live Scribe 3.
Scribe 3.
Now for Android.
Review available at pocketnow.com. One more piece of news, and it's in our headline, so we gotta talk about it very briefly.
The iPhone 6S.
I guess notice how much that sounds like iPhone 6S.
iPhone 6S. I was just going to say, how many third-party retailers are going to take advantage of that?
I don't think it's going to be called iPhone 6. There are other rumors that it's going to be called the iPhone 7, but these news are from KGI. They've gotten iPhone predictions right almost every single time for the past couple of years. And we've got a couple of predictions here, starting with the hardware. Apparently, we're going to continue with the 4.7 and 5.5-inch models. They're not saying if we're getting a redesign, but those are going to be the screen sizes. And those iPhone mini rumors of the 4-inch display, you can forget about them, according to KGI. Other rumors are that the materials will change. We've heard previous rumors of the iPhone getting stronger materials, the Apple Watch materials. What's that aluminum grade for the Apple Watch?
Oh, 7,000,
something like that.
Yeah, 7,000. Okay, so apparently we're getting that. And that is going to help against the bend problems of the iPhone 6 Plus. we're even hearing that the phablet model will have limited quantities of a sapphire display option. You can buy it. Apparently, it's going to be a more premium option, but it's going to be limited quantities. And probably the biggest news when it comes to hardware is that we're getting another color option, this time rose gold, to match that rose gold Apple Watch that you didn't buy because only Katy Perry could afford. When it comes to internals, we've got obviously the A9 processor. That's obviously going to be the name. It's follow the same trends as the iPhone 4. Apparently, we're getting an upgrade to 2 gigs of RAM, finally.
Hey, tide is turning.
Now, even though Apple has never admitted how much RAM their phones have, you know, teardowns just reveal that.
Why would we care about something silly like that?
Yeah, I know. Especially used to it. So it seems we are getting improvements to Touch ID, and we are finally getting a 12-megapixel camera. Just for context, the last time the camera got an upgrade, at least in megapixel count, was in the iPhone 4S.
Wow, that was when they jumped to 8 from 5, yeah?
Yeah, that was when Steve Jobs passed away. That was the day. So that's how old the 8-megapixel model has existed. Obviously, they've grown the pixels and stuff like that. But yeah, this is, in a nutshell, what the predictions are for the iPhone 6 Plus and iPhone 6S and iPhone 6S Plus. What a horrible name.
Yeah. We'll see what names they ultimately go with. But most importantly, Jaime, what I want to know, is there any word on whether these racing stripes are going to disappear from the back cover? Because I'd sure like for them to go away.
No. Racing stripes. Man. You are too nice, Michael.
Oh, God. It looks just, ugh. But I, you know, I've had to use the iPhone 6 for the past 2 weeks because it's been the Apple Watch companion, and there's so many great things about that experience, so many wonderful things. But between the embedded antenna loops and the iOS home screen, I'm just still not a fan of the overall experience. For me personally, it's a great phone for almost everyone else in the world, apparently, especially in Boston. I've said it a million times. You look around I sat on a bus the other day. 5 people around me were all looking at their phones. Every single one of them was an iPhone. It's unbelievable here. The saturation.
It happens almost everywhere. And part of the predictions are that Apple will sell 80 to 90 million units before 2015 ends. That's the end of the prediction.
Of just the new models?
Of the new models.
Wow.
Oh, well, by the way, no. I'm talking crap here. Apple never confirms what models these are, but that's the amount of iPhones that they plan to sell. It seems like all incremental upgrades, but that's the way Apple usually does things with the S models. That's the way it works. They keep the design. We wish they don't, because my God, those stripes are just horrible. They make the phone. They make me want to use a case, and I hate that.
Amen to that. Despite the fact that I've got some of those Mophie juice packs over here, and those are among my favorite things ever, just because of the idea of extending a phone's endurance with an add-on case that's actually sort of low impact is effing terrific.
I've never used the Mophie. Actually.
Never used a Mophie. You know what? Never used a Mophie. All right, anyway, let's move on. Jules, why don't we officially kick it off and get to answering some questions from the people in a segment called Gadgets in Hand.
This NBC News broadcast is brought to you by who?
So Apple has this reputation. Now, I emphasize reputation. It's not always true, but it often is. That it rolls out products that do less than competitors, but do it better. So with its first proper smartwatch, Apple's taking a different tack, doing just as much as most of the competition, and still trying to do it better. Does it succeed? We've got to read our Apple Watch review to find out, but I bet you can intimate the answer from the answers we give to your questions right now. And because he's on the team, and because I told him to have some dang frickin' questions ready for me, because he's our number one Apple fan, I want to give the floor to Jaime Rivera to ask me anything he wants to know about the Apple Watch, which I'm wearing right now. It's the Apple Watch Sport Edition, and spoiler alert, I like it a lot. Go ahead, Jaime.
Why did you order it in white?
I didn't.
The first question actually is related to the thumbnail we have on the rundown. Is that a red mark on your arm?
Yeah, it is.
Is it that uncomfortable?
So the deal is that it's not uncomfortable, but when you are using the band, so when you affix it to your wrist, the band...
Michael.
Yes, I'm still with you. Jaime, are you still with me?
I lost you there for a second, but there you go.
Oh, okay, but we're back now. So when you put it on your wrist, this fluoroelastomer band is actually really comfortable, but I find it most comfortable when it's a little on the tight side. If it's loose and rattling around, it's less comfortable. So I tend to wear it on the tight side, and I will turn my camera on and see if I can get it. So I wear it tight enough to imprint its image sort of on me, and that's why you're seeing that in the photos. If you wear it looser, that won't happen. But the window on the back with the health sensors does protrude slightly, which you can't really see in the pictures, but it does stick out just a little bit, and that results in some imprints if you wear it as tightly as I do. So I wouldn't worry about it.
Okay. Because I don't know. I've heard that it's heavy, and I can't wait to get it from you.
Yeah, well, it's about 81 grams with the band and the casing included. And that seems to me to be the perfect balance between heft and portability.
I don't know what the weight is on this Moto X, but it is darn heavy.
The Moto 360?
The 360, sorry.
But you also have a band that appears to be forged out of the hulls of retired frigates. So
retired frigates. This is the original Moto X band, by the way.
Oh, okay. I thought it was custom.
And it is gorgeous. I'm not complaining. It's just, I guess for me, and we were having this conversation with you yesterday, now we're making it live, I have fallen in love with the Moto 360, not because it's a great smartwatch. Not really. It is not. For what a smartwatch... No, it is a beautiful watch, per se, regardless. It is something that whenever I go to a Starbucks, whenever I go to a store, wherever it is that I go, everybody's like, my God, what a beautiful watch. What do you get?
Is that the Apple Watch?
No.
Is the Apple Watch?
Actually, nobody's asked me if this is the Apple Watch. And everybody's like, my God, that is a beautiful watch. And I just love the way it looks. I hate the way it performs. I really don't like Android Wear, and I don't like it because, if I just got a WhatsApp message and I got the alert and I want to interact with it, it's like it's only a one-way thing. I can't call on WhatsApp to contact somebody. I have to open it in the phone regardless of what I want, because the only way I can interact with WhatsApp is if I get an alert. And I notice that the Apple Watch performs differently. You can call on things and have them work for you.
Right, because the Apple Watch is much more app-centric, keeping with exactly what you'd expect from Apple. You have not only it's not just a window into your notifications. I mean, you literally press the button and you have a screen that's full of apps. And the watch is actually so good at knowing when you're looking at it that I can't show it to you right now because it keeps turning off when I turn it to the camera. But I love that about it. I love some of the refinements that Apple has built in that make this so much better than the 360 in some of those everyday ways, and better than most competitors. But on the flip side, though, I can go to this app launcher and find WhatsApp or find whatever and be able to do more, there is increased complexity in terms of the interface. which doesn't make it unpleasant to use, but it does mean that for the first couple days you're going, what the hell is happening? I don't know what I'm doing with this.
Isn't this a necessary evil of a powerful smartwatch? And try to dumb down the interface too much, you're going to lose the sort of flexibility that's making the Apple Watch so appealing. So there's going to be that little getting used to how this works introductory period, but...
Yes, mm-hmm. There is, but Apple does offer a sort of nice on-ramp to it, which Google beat them to the punch with, but it concerns a user question, so I'll say it. Matthew Kimber says, did you find yourself using Siri more on the watch than you would on an iPhone? I must admit I've never really felt much need for it on my phone, nor do I routinely talk to Google now on my OnePlus One, but does the watch do more to necessitate it? It doesn't do more to necessitate it, but it makes using the watch easier if you remember that you can just say, hey, Siri, and then set an alarm or do something or, you know, whatever.
No, and I use Siri a lot. And I guess
phone?
Yeah, I do. But I guess my biggest... I don't really talk to Android Wear because I hate the fact that it doesn't respond to me.
What, that like, it doesn't give you like a... That it doesn't respond to you like Cortana or Siri? What is a person?
Right. It doesn't give you a voice response, and so you have to wait. You have to ask it something, and then you have to wait for the answer and then read it. So it's a one-way thing, and that's really what I don't like about Android Wear. I don't like that it's a one-way interaction. Either it alerts me and I can interact, or I can talk to it, and then I won't get a response. It's, I don't know, Android Wear for me is just weird. I'm not saying that the Apple Watch is better. I actually, like, for example, I noticed in your review that the Apple launch times are very sluggish. I also noticed that the UI is like the complete opposite of an iPhone. It is just so convoluted.
No, it's not. It's actually not the opposite of an iPhone, Jaime. It's a distillation of exactly what the iPhone interface is, actually. Like, think about it. The home screen, so the home screen is there with all the springboard and the app, you know, the apps and all that kind of stuff, and you've got the clock faces. So those are your two kind of home screens. To get to your notifications, what do? You swipe down from the top. To get to your control center and, you know, various other miniaturized cards, you swipe up from the bottom. So it's not unintuitive in theory. It's just the way that it's implemented, mainly because there are so many new control paradigms that Apple's trying to do. You've got, in addition to touch or press and long press, you've got force touch, and then you've got the digital crown, which you press in not to select something. What's that?
But you don't really need it. It zooms in and out, but you can also do it like scrolling, for example. You can also do it on the display without the need of the crown, for example.
Yeah, and actually, but I wish the crown was implemented in more places, because half the time, like, I would love it if you were in the glance screens and you could use the crown to scroll through glances, but you can't. You can only use it to zoom in and scroll through lists. But the more annoying thing is that if you are using the digital crown to scroll through a list and it has a little highlight that moves as you move the crown, when you press in on the crown, you expect it to select that item. And instead, what it does is it takes you back.
Go home. Goes home.
Which is just dumb. So what Apple wants to do is the same thing Samsung has been forcing us to do on their phones for generations and generations, is to switch from the mental state of, I'm pushing a physical button, which here is the digital crown. On Samsung phones, it's their physical home button. And on the iPhone, too, actually. Switch from a physical button to, okay, now I'm going to interact with a touchscreen, and they're going to be different things. And on a watch, that's just much worse.
Yeah, they should have used the other button as the home button.
They should have used the other button as the home button. That's what I'm saying, because the other button is relegated to just being this friends list, which, by the way, you can then, you know, you can move around the friends wheel with your digital crown, and once again, select, oh no, select brings me back to the springboard instead of actually calling Adam Lane like I just wanted to. So that's frustrating. So Matthew Kimber, to answer your question, Siri simplifies a lot of this. You spend a lot of time, I feel like, with the Apple Watch deciding, remembering how you're supposed to interact with it, like what control you're supposed to use when. And Siri just sort of usually cuts through all that shit. Like, you know, it's like, give me walking directions to Boston Burger Company. And then boom.
Boston Burger Company.
It's a great place to go there. Burgers if you live in Boston. It's really great.
Well, you'll take me there. And my other question is phone calls. I mean, can you really... you've used every single gear that's ever been. Like the original Samsung Galaxy Gear, the Gear 2, you've used the Gear S. You've actually had to make phone calls with these watches. How would you compare the Apple Watch to these products? Because, you know, I do find that cool. I do find it cool to be driving, to get a phone call, and to not have to pull my phone or connect it to the car stereo or stuff like that. I could just talk to the watch.
It is
the worst of them all.
Okay.
The Gear S is the loudest one I've ever used, and that's because the Gear S is a massive bracelet. There's another one that I can't remember right now that actually has a pretty good speakerphone, too.
The Gear 2, I think it was.
Maybe, but there's an Android Wear device that has a... Or not? No, it's not. It's not an Android Wear device.
You can't talk to Android.
No, you can't. I can't. Maybe it was the original Gear that I'm thinking of, the Galaxy Gear. But in any case, Apple had to make a small smartwatch, and even at the 42-millimeter size, I think this speakerphone driver is just not big enough, or they didn't want to use a powerful enough component at the risk of battery drain, so they put in this tiny, tinny little thing. It stinks. So I will never... For notifications, it's actually pretty loud. This is a problem that we've seen on phones before, too. I don't know how the mic quality is. Jules is asking a very good question in the chat. I actually am not sure. People haven't complained when I've taken calls on the watch, but I've made those calls very short because it is so unpleasant. Like, it just has to be a totally quiet room to use the thing, and that's really frustrating. So
it's really pointless, I guess.
Yeah, but I'm surprised that Apple built it in at all, because as much as of a nerd as I am, and as much as I enjoyed taking the Gear S out on the town untethered and like taking phone calls on my wrist and pretending like I was 9 and having a good time again, pretending like I was in the future, it's not something that's comfortable, or and it makes people look at you funny, and you have to expose your conversation to the entire room around you. Yeah. And it doesn't
seem like something people are asking for, and right. I don't know that's necessarily the reason Apple wouldn't do it, but if Apple were to do something like that, I would expect it to do it really, really well and convince people, no, you guys actually do want to do this because it's such a great experience, whereas this feels like utterly failing in that regard.
And it does, yeah. Where it's much more successful is in the much more traditional roles of the smartwatch, which is as a notification portal and a simplified version.
I love we've finally gotten to the point where we have the traditional role for a smartwatch to compare things against.
Right. This is progress. This is progress.
Right.
Now, Michael.
Yeah, go ahead, Amy.
One last question.
Keep going.
Now, tell me something. You've used pretty much everything out there. Would you consider that Apple's approach is overbearing when compared to everything else? I mean, I feel that this is like the complete opposite of what Apple does. Apple is usually the company that starts with something very simple and then starts adding features as time goes by. But then this Apple Watch is like gimmick central. Like, the emoticons are gimmicks. The amount of options you have everywhere, some of them are gimmicks. The fact that one button is used for contacts or for making phone calls, I consider to be a gimmick. I don't know. It's just, I feel that they overdid what you can do with a watch. And that's not necessarily bad, but this is not Apple at all.
So, yeah, I guess there's a couple ways to look at that. I mean, in one respect, it is sort of like they're ripping off Samsung's approach of like, well, let's throw everything we can think of into this thing, which is not usually a great way to go, and it's never the way Apple goes, which is odd. But in another way, it sort of does take the sting out of the price tag of this watch, because the phone call example, that's just bad. That shouldn't be in here. But there are a lot of other things that appear complex initially, but once you get used to them, you're really happy to have. Like, the fact that I can customize every aspect of almost every watch face, and like, it's so that now when I look at my watch at a glance, I have battery level, exercise, outside temperature, and like sunset time, for example. And I can set all those to be whatever I want at any given time. That's really useful. That's really cool. You know, the fact that the exercise meter is done really well and is really easy to instantly understand and instantly interpret, and it's apparently actually a pretty accurate heart rate sensor too, from what we're reporting.
Yeah, so we've seen.
You know, that's great. The fact that the straight up regular stuff like timers and countdowns and all that, the clock. I mean,
it tells time good. That's good for a while.
Right. Right. Exactly. Yeah. Right. It works right. And the fact that they've built in. The Apple has proven twice now that they can start from nothing, first in smartphones, then in tablets, with an app ecosystem and create, incite developers to create an ecosystem. They're going to do it for the watch, and you know that some of the stuff we're going to see is just going to be awesome for it. We're already starting to see some really cool stuff for it. Being able to do Yelp or Evernote right on the watch is actually one of those areas where the digital crown shines, because you can read everything while you're scrolling. So, like... You know, I don't know. I feel like that all this stuff offsets the fact that, yeah, a lot of the stuff they're trying here doesn't really work, and they really need to hone that interface, you know? So I don't know. It's a mixed bag, certainly, if that answers your question at all.
Okay.
People were saying that the app launch on the Apple Watch can be really bad. How bad is bad? I don't. It's not really bad. I mean, I don't know. I feel like I'm justifying there where I don't necessarily have to be. It's not fun.
Like running iOS 8 on a 4-year-old iPhone.
Yeah, and it's funny because people are asking about lag, and it's not really lag. It's just waiting for the watch to talk to the phone, and like there's a bottleneck at the Bluetooth connection, and there's presumably some sort of bottleneck at the S1 processor. I don't know, but it's not fun to hit Yelp and say, okay, opening Yelp. It's really not fun to open an app for the first time and have the watch tell you, okay, you need to get your phone out to give it permission to access your contacts or whatever. Like, there's some stuff there that's not well thought out. But then again, if my phone's in my bag, like it often is, and I just want to like be like, okay, I want to go to lose it and see if I can enter some calorie information real quick. Right now it's taking 4, 5, 6, 7. It is thoroughly missing like any kind of usability score. It's failing utterly right now at launching an app. So that's frustrating. But I don't know. It doesn't bother me frequently enough because I'm not using the third party app so much. I don't know. I mean, what would you guys use on a regular basis from the apps that you've seen? I mean, Steven, yeah, you're probably an outlier in this question, but what app am I routinely starting from the watch? I mean, you know, I'm using it, again, in that traditional sense more often. I'm not using it to scroll the Instagram feed, even though I can. It's a very small screen. It's kind of a stupid use for that. I'm using it to hit me on the wrist and tell me, hey, you've got a Hangout message. You want to reply? Yeah, okay, I will. Like that, you know. I'm using it to tell me I've got a phone call. I'm using it to find my phone when I've lost my phone. I'm just, you know, not using it for as a mini iPhone, which I feel like a lot of people expect to be the thing.
I actually don't want that to be the thing.
So, like, in what? Go ahead. I mean, to talk about that.
Like, again, I feel that a lot of things are again, they're overbearing. The more a watch can do. The more, like, for example, I do notice a lot of public etiquette issues with constantly looking at your watch for things.
Sure,
like, people always ask me, like, you have to go somewhere?
Yeah, like, got somewhere okay? to be? I'm not interesting enough?
Got somewhere to be? Yeah. It's like, yeah, and it is just so, for people, it is extremely disturbing. It's
more so like, than phones, like, do you think?
Well, but that's the thing. It's like, so here's the thing. It's rare. You do find people that are willing to put up a phone in front of somebody while that person is talking to you. Yes, there are rude people out there. But with the phone, there is just a bigger barrier. You know, you hear that your notifications and everything, but if you're talking to somebody, you ignore them while you talk to that person, and then you act on these things. But with the watch, it's like, it is a little more, I don't know, it's like if it asks for more of your attention. And for people, yeah. You know, for people, it's already socially understood that if you pull out your phone, it's because it's something you need to look at, yes. But when it comes to the watch, all people think of is there something you need to do? Am I too boring? I don't know. I feel that it's still a problem. It's like Google Glass. As cool as it can be, nobody likes for you to be pointing a camera at them constantly.
I can appreciate that, the idea of it interrupting you. When I was playing with the Martian Notifier last year, which is just doing notifications, I remember a couple times I'm out on a bike ride, and every, you know, 5 minutes or so, I feel this little buzz at my wrist, and none of the notifications are at all pertinent to what I'm doing at the moment, but it's annoying to have to go in and silence certain, I don't want to get Twitter updates while I'm doing this or so-and-so. Because it's always trying to keep you connected. You don't necessarily want to be all the time. I think we haven't quite gotten to the point with our relationship with smartwatches where we've clearly defined how intrusive we want them to be in our lives. We like to have them there and want the connectivity and the options they offer, but I don't know that we're necessarily sold on the constant bombardments like we are with the smartphone.
And I think smartwatches are not there to bombard you constantly. It would be my argument that if you're wearing a smartwatch and it's completely hitting you up all the time with notifications, you're doing it wrong, or the watch is doing it wrong. And
either of those is a possibility, depending on what watch you're using. But almost all of them you can configure based on what notifications you want to receive, just like you can configure a phone. So it's my argument that the purpose of a smartwatch fundamentally is to make you spend less time on your phone, because you don't need to spend as much time on your phone, because half the notifications you're getting you probably don't need to act on, but you would like to know what they say, and it's much easier to look at your wrist than it is to fish out your phone.
That's you make a solid. You do make a solid point. But again, I think Stephen makes another solid point with, you know, going on a bike ride. I wish that phones. You remember those old days when Nokia phones had this like you would press the power button and you could select. You either want it didn't only give you silence options, but it would tell you like meeting mode, like loud mode, normal mode, and it would control absolutely everything in your phone. In the old Nokia Symbian days. I wish that phones had that, like there was a more enhanced do not disturb, like say I'm going, you know, I'm training at the gym, an option for training.
Like priority notifications.
Like, exactly, and you define within those, like I don't want to get email, I don't want to get this, but then, you know, my run is only going to last an hour, so once my run is done, I want to switch back to everything else and do it, you know, seamlessly, something really quick. I feel that that's like something that we're missing, because yes, I do love the fact that a smartwatch would save me the need to be like, oh, I don't, this is an SMS, I don't need to pull my phone for that. Cool. It is, it's just, again, it's that thing where you're probably with somebody talking to somebody and they just become annoyed at you constantly looking at the watch. They do.
Yeah, there are etiquette questions that this re-raises. And actually, I had a question queued up in the Q&A, and I just lost it because I was trying to ask Jules to clarify a point he was making about, well, are these things meant to bring us closer to technology or to encourage us to spend more time away from it? And Jaime, were you just saying that you wanted it to, like, to be seamless, what, in the form of like a cellular radio? Like you want it to be, you want it to be self-contained when you're away from your phone?
No. What I want is for there to be like sort of a, so there's do not disturb on the iPhone, and within do not disturb you have either or. You either allow notifications or disallow notifications.
Yes.
And you also have,
and
those
watch has the same setting, by the way. Yeah.
Right. So I wish that these applications would give you the option to define themes, like if, you know, you have like a gym theme. And so you tell the phone that when you set it to gym mode, you don't want to get notifications from social, from Facebook.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, very good.
From that. Yeah. All I want is alerts that are pertaining to what I'm doing.
Sure.
And so, right. So
and you
like,
can already do that on Android Wear with priority alerts, pretty much. I mean, it's not context aware based on what you're doing at the time, but you can set it to priority alerts, and then it knows to only let in calls from, like, your parents or whatever.
Exactly. So that's the problem. Right now the model is either or. I wish that we could go back to the old Nokia days where you would press the power button, and it would give you the option to create different, like, meeting mode or stuff like that. And
Right. You
just switch quickly to it, and you define within that what you want it to do. I wish that you know, with as we're moving into smartwatches, that these options would.
I had an old Samsung flip phone that could do that.
Jules brings up a point. We do have to move off of this in a few minutes, so I want to get as many of these Q&As in as possible. Nathan Alvarez is saying, in your opinion, will smartwatches be more of a need-to-buy product when they become autonomous and not tethered to a smartphone? No, I do not think that at all. Gentlemen, I'm going to let you weigh in a second. No, I think these are smartphone accessories. I think building in a cellular radio is impressive in a technical sense. It's interesting in the sense that, okay, I could theoretically go out on the town with just my watch and still be connected, but no one's done that correctly yet, and I don't know if it's possible to do. Then you've got the whole carrier issue of you're spending monthly money on another line on your mobile phone plan, and that's crazy for a watch that doesn't do enough to justify it, I don't think. I mean, $10 a month is not a lot, but Stephen, what do you think?
I'm tempted to side with you, and there's a very there, but I'm thinking back to when smartphones and tablets first arrived. I was saying the exact same thing. People are never going to abandon computers for these. You can't do as much. They're harder to use. You're paying extra for connectivity, yet there are very much people who use these now as their primary devices. 5-10 years from now, will people think, oh, a smartphone, I'm going to carry around that big piece of junk in my pocket with everything I need right on my wrist here. So I'm willing to concede that the technology may catch up And people who are who start using these things from the underage will get used to them, and they will come to expect the smaller screen and maybe more limited things you can get done with this as the standard. So I don't want to say hard and fast that this is a non-starter here.
Hi, ma'am. I'm going to let you answer, but Stephen, you bring up an interesting point, and I'm going to say that if you were to be able to come up with a smartwatch that was about as sleek as the Apple Watch, which, by the way, one of the great things about it is that it is one of the smaller ones available, and it's really unobtrusive. If you were able to make a device like this that also had functionality like the Huawei TalkBand B2 with an integrated Bluetooth earpiece, I used that thing from Malta and during my time in Malta, and that was way cooler than I thought it was going to be. It might, if it did more, it might bring back the concept of the Bluetooth headset as a workable thing. Mm. But maybe I'm just high and drunk. Jaime, what's your answer?
My opinion is that there are certain things that should be autonomous of every smartwatch, but not everything. For example, when it comes to fitness, the last thing that I want to do when I go to a run is carry a phone. Mm. I want my watch to be able to tell me everything and then sync with the phone when I get there. And for me, that's the most ridiculous part about Android Wear. You got 4 gigs of RAM. It allows me to store music, but the data of my run cannot be stored for me to go sync it with the phone later. And I feel that, yes, there are certain things like fitness which definitely do need to be autonomous. And until they figure that part out, Garmins are still going to be in business. Because sure. that's the biggest flaw. Why do people love Garmins? Why do you see every runner with a Garmin? True runners, by the way. You don't see true runners with a phone. You see them with a Garmin. Why? Because what you want is true GPS tracking, and you want it to help you, and so many things that Garmins can do, depending on what you buy. That's what's missing. And when they get that right, I feel that smartwatches are going to take off to the niche leave the niche that they're currently stuck on, because people still don't find a use for them. And again, why is this Fitbit so popular? Because yes, it syncs with the phone, but you don't need to be carrying the phone for it to work.
Man, you trust those GPS satellites? When I go for a run, I'm using that big circle on a stick surveyor tool, rolling the thing along in front of me. I know exactly how far I ran.
To the millimeter. I know the distance I covered. Do you think the digital crown is a good idea, asks Jonas Gamow. Would you rather prefer if Apple just used the normal swipe the screen method, or should they make the digital crown better? Jonas, the last one. They should make they're going to refine the digital crown. They have to. But it's
such
a great idea.
Physical control, yeah.
It is. I mean, we've said it so many times, but the fact that this concept of this turnable thing on the side of a watch has been around since wristwatches have been around, and now it's being put to a new use, it is... It's genius in its simplicity. So it absolutely needs to stick around. I just think it needs some refinement. Which would all of you actually use daily, the Apple Watch or the Microsoft Band, asks Joseph Scavella. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. I must tell you that there is no way I would ever use the Microsoft Band if I was given that choice. The Microsoft Band is maybe a retail product, but as we've said before, it's a... It's much more useful to think of it as a baseline reference device so that other manufacturers can try to outdo it using its functionality. Now, that being said, Jaime's on the show. We talk about fitness. The Microsoft Band has, I believe, many more self-contained sensors than the Apple Watch does. It's a better fitness tracker, certainly.
What else does it have in there?
It's got integrated GPS and a bunch of... like motion stuff and things and whatever. Actually, I don't know. I don't know what makes the GPS different specifically. I haven't even thought about the Microsoft Band in a long time. Sorry, but I just wanted to say that this question is sort of important as a contrast study. It's like how Microsoft and Apple release products. Microsoft pushed out the Band and charged people sort of for the privilege of beta testing it, which I didn't think was very cool. And it's clunky and nasty and uncomfortable, and its screen scratches if you look at it wrong. Like, it's just, I don't think it's a very good product.
Or wearable is the last thing you want.
You know, exactly.
Before we get too far away from this here, and I know we're pressed on time, but talking about the digital crown, I've got to ask, considering the affinity we seem to have for it, what would you think about getting a physical scroll wheel on the side of a smartphone?
A physical scroll wheel? Like, what do you mean a physical scroll
just
wheel?
Just like the wheel that's on the side of a mouse here. That you scroll, just like put it on the side, like a volume button that you can quickly scroll through a document, that it clicks.
Like a jog dial?
Yeah.
I mean, it wouldn't. I would hate it because I would want it to be.
What's the difference between the phone and the?
Because the crown looks like it's meant to be there, whereas the jog dial. I would always be thinking about how much space the jog dial is taking up on the inside. If you were to replace it, Stephen, with a touch-sensitive strip, like we've talked about before on some of those old Windows handhelds, I think that could maybe work. But then you're still missing out on the opportunity to make this old thing, this old and outdated...
Right, you were trying to shoehorn something
structural
here.
Element. Better. Anyway. Yeah. It looks like we've lost Jaime, everybody, hopefully we'll be able to get him back. I want to squeeze in one or two more questions here, and then we'll go ahead and move on from this thing. And sorry, this is always sort of a little bit here and there, back and forth, when we're doing the question and answer, but I feel like I've been making a much stronger case for not buying the Apple Watch than for buying it. And I guess this dovetails nicely with this J. Raphael RDZ question. Do you think the Pebble Time will be a worthy competitor for the other wearables? It doesn't seem to be related, but it is.
When
trust me.
When did that finally get here? Another month or two?
Yeah, about. I keep getting a freaking Kickstarter update email every day. If so many have stopped reading them. So, I don't know. It'll get here when it gets here. I've got mine on order. I don't know anymore. I don't know the answer to this question. In the iOS world, Pebble was unquestionably the best option there was for a long time if you wanted an iPhone-compatible smartwatch.
Right.
And it's still a great smartwatch. I'm sure the Pebble Time will be a great smartwatch. But the Apple Watch, if you own an iPhone and if you want something that has the same fit and finish, has the same industrial look, and echoes the software experience and integrates tightly with the software experience, there's nothing that even gets in the same galaxy, no pun intended, as the Apple Watch. It is far and away the best option to get if you're buying a smartwatch for your iPhone, and that is going to hold true even if and when Android Wear devices become compatible with iOS someday. I have a feeling. I don't know that for sure. I just have a feeling because if you own an iPhone, the Apple Watch is really, really enjoyable to use. And it makes you not mind the fact that you're not using your iPhone as much. It's a clunky way to say it. So I don't know how the Pebble Time is gonna fare against
the Apple
Watch.
I wish that it came out a year ago instead of the Pebble Steel, if we got Pebble Time and it had another year to catch up to build its ecosystem with these colored apps. I mean, Apple would still be destroying it on iOS, but I think the head start there would have given it a much better chance at cross-platform adoption.
Indeed. Jaime, welcome back. Everyone, thank you for your questions in the Q&A. We do have to move on. You have had wonderfully intelligent questions, and it's been great, but our producer has to move us along because we have to stick to a thing. Stick to the schedule. We are entering a segment that we haven't visited in a few weeks, so it seems only right to introduce it. This is a segment called Dial F for Fail. Apparently we don't have a drop.
We have no.
Well, that's okay. This is a segment all about missteps.
Something, yeah.
Misdeeds, injustice, general foolishness, of course, within the mobile industry. Today's topic, the LG G4's once denied, now confirmed, quick charging capability. Why don't you know what your own phone can do? And how much of this is our fault? Stephen Schenck, you have 5 minutes. Take it away.
So much head shaking going on here. So, as you likely know, LG just introduced the G4 the other week. It's 2015 flagship. It's competing against phones like the Galaxy S6 and the HTC One M9, both of which do a little thing called supporting Qualcomm's quick charge. It's built into the Snapdragon processors. It allows you to charge your phone super duper quickly. Generally, in about an hour, you can go from nothing to a full charge. And even putting it head on head with another non-quick charge power adapter with the same current output, the quick charge one is going to work a lot faster. So when it came time for the G4 to launch, we had lots of questions about how it would stack up to these other heavyweights. One of them being, does it have this quick charge support? After all, it's running a Snapdragon 808. Sure, it may not be the 810 on higher end phones like the like the G Flex 2 before it. It's an even higher end, but to the point we were very curious if it had this. And as us industry people started learning about the phone, we asked LG, it told us in no uncertain terms, no, the G4 does not support it. I have my notes here from the G4 launch event, and I wrote down here, no Qualcomm Quick Charge. So that's what everyone's reporting. And we had no reason to believe it wasn't true. It seemed a little weird, because like, it's built into the 808, but it's not the first time that there have been these features inherent to Snapdragon processors that don't get fully taken advantage of, like the ability for the phone with the DSP to, you know, listen to audio while it's asleep. Motorola did its own thing with the X8, but, you know, by and large, this wasn't really adopted. So it wasn't crazy. We were willing to believe that maybe this feature is in there, LG just didn't turn it on. Well, fast forward to this week when someone in LG talked to someone else in LG and realized, oh, no, wait, this actually does support Quick Charge. We just didn't bundle it with a Quick Charge adapter and told everyone it didn't work. But sure enough, if you go out and you buy a Quick Charge compatible adapter or just have one lying around from another smartphone that came with it, then yeah, it will work just fine. And Michael went ahead and tested this, and sure enough, the G4 is charging lickety-split as if it was designed from the ground up with Quick Charge support. This is nothing short of hugely embarrassing for LG, because if anyone should know what your smartphone can do, it should be you, the company who released it. That said, I don't want to be too harsh about LG and its role here in denying the Quick Charge support for the G4, because smartphones are hugely complicated, and they are a group effort. You have the engineers, you have engineers both hardware and software, you have design people, you have marketing people. And the fact that some details might not get properly communicated between all these different groups isn't unheard of, especially when LG probably somewhere along the line decided not to emphasize this. It instead wanted to point out how the G4 has a removable battery. And we were told that LG wanted to make a big deal about this, especially now that Samsung doesn't have the support with the Galaxy S6. LG wanted to show how easy it is to go from a discharged battery to a full battery just by swapping in a new one. And certainly that's a lot faster than quick charging. It would be even better, though, if they would have just admitted from the start, yes, it does quick charging. Yes, you can swap out the battery. And hell, if it had integrated wireless charging, that would be better still. Yes, the G4 does wireless charging, but without a built-in back like the GS6 has, you're going to have to go pick up an accessory to make that work. So, missed opportunity, and this is super unfortunate because LG has always been sort of the black sheep of these Android flagships. It's always been, for the last few years at least, been a few months later than HTC and Samsung. It doesn't quite have the same fan base as HTC does, and certainly doesn't have anywhere near the numbers that Samsung does. So it needs all the help it can get. And yeah, the camera and the G4 is fantastic, but just these little things that LG could have done differently to really show that the G4 is at least on the same footing as these other flagships, to have people considering it in the same thought when they're going out to shop for these, it's just a lost opportunity. LG really should have had its junk together for this from the get-go. It certainly had enough time. I guess.
Can I talk about our role in this?
Here? Absolutely, jump on it.
Just as we're wrapping up, all good points, Stephen. I completely agree. I want to make it clear that we did half our jobs, and by we, I mean I. I'm going to take the hit for this.
We cannot put full responsibility on LG here.
No. So we had a lot of people writing to us saying, hey, the 808 supports Quick Charge. What are you talking about? So we actually did take that to LG and was like, yeah, what is the deal? All the 800 series support Quick Charge. Are you sure? They actually did come back and tell us, yes, the chip supports it, but the phone doesn't have the hardware that's needed for it. So we were like, oh, okay. So that's what we reported. And then a couple days later, they came back and told us, oh, actually, we made a mistake. It has Quick Charge. That's all fine. This could have been sorted out by me the first day I had the device just by plugging it into my Nexus 6 charger and timing out that charge time. I didn't think that was necessary because I assumed
they will know this.
But this is not the first time we've run into a situation like this, and actually, in retrospect, I should have timed it out first. I'm not broken up. I'm not losing any sleep about it, but I will take a bit of the responsibility for not verifying those claims. And by the way, I think Cam Bunton at PhoneDog and at least somebody else, I think maybe Dom or somebody at other sites, when I tweeted our story about, oh, it has quick charging, they were like, yeah, I knew that. We plugged it in, and it obviously has quick charging. I'm like, oh, well, thanks for letting me.
Yeah, not everyone swallowed the LG party line there.
Yeah. It's like, yeah. Anyway, thank you very much for that, Stephen. Sorry to cut your DFFF short.
About next week.
But yes, it's good to have it back, and it's wonderful. Mm-hmm. Listener mail. So, Jules, sound the thing. Bong, bong.
Bing, bong.
Thank you, sir. Wonderful. See, we have a sound drop for that. The device confusion. This is from Ed Carden, my college friend who I'm going to see very soon. Hello, Michael and Steven, or Adam and Hayato, or whoever's doing the show this week. I've been wearing an LG G watch since I received it as a gift this past Christmas. People ask me about it constantly. At first, it was along the lines of, hey, is that one of those smartwatches? Nowadays, though, it's always, is that the Apple Watch? This has become extremely annoying. And my question is, how do you all, as frequent users of new and eye-grabbing personal tech, deal with this sort of thing? I figure there's probably a better alternative to anti-Apple tirades and punches to the face.
Ah, that would be my suggestion.
I'm also curious to know if there are any devices that you have carried that were especially prone to this sort of confusion. All the best, Ed Carden. Ed, thank you for writing in. Jaime, do you want to answer any of those really, very, very quickly?
Is that the new Galaxy? I would get that all the time.
Yep.
Is that the new Galaxy? Oh, wow. All right. And all I would respond is yes. Yeah.
No matter what it was.
You know. Like, yeah. Yeah. So is that the Apple Watch? Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, of course.
Does it look like the Apple Watch?
Steven, you don't have new gadgets out in public all that often, so this probably doesn't happen to you at all, right?
Yeah, and I don't go showing them off either. You guys waving around your stuff like you're the
I am being all flashy about it, but sometimes, so to answer one of your questions specifically, Ed, yeah, some phones you can't help but flash around because of their nature. I remember using the HTC One Max in public, and people would, like, interrupt me. Even if I was having, like, a particularly, like, a discussion that looked serious, people would, like, interrupt my phone calls, like, I'm sorry, is that a tablet or a phone? And it's like, yeah, it's a monster, right? It's sort of in between. You want to talk?
Yeah.
So yeah, the generally the big devices are the more eye-catching ones, or you know, the more coverage they get in like pre-release press, the more likely I am to be stopped on the street. I've been stopped for the Apple Watch so many times, but before then, and we've talked about it earlier in the show, Jaime, the 360. Anytime I wear, oh, is that the Apple Watch? And my friend wears a 360 as well, and I see people stop him all the time, and it's like, oh, is it the Apple Watch? And that's been happening forever. So, Ed, my canned response to that, for someone like yourself, who's probably not tired of talking about technology by the time the day is done, if you want to have a conversation. It's. I think the great response is like, no, this actually came out way before it, and it does some things better and some things the same. You want to see it? And then, you know.
This is actually a secret prototype Apple Watch, which I could let off my hands for $2,000.
Yeah, roughly $3,000 or so. You got some extra clams? And Jules makes a good point. He says, whenever you tell people it's not the Apple Watch, because Jules has experienced this too, the G-Watch R, it's almost always like, oh, okay. Which is even more like fuel for this thing of like, yeah, no, okay, but no, like expand your mind for a second. I know, like you asked me, you started this conversation with me, so I'm going to tell you that Apple was not the first one on the scene, and this does some things better, so hey.
I haven't gotten any comments like, is that the Apple Watch, but what I do get is like, what is that, when they see the 360?
Oh, yeah.
Because notifications on the round display are so in your face, they're just so, they look very big. Yeah. People are like, oh, what is that? Oh, that's
actually
cool.
A BLT sandwich.
Sorry, I've got to move us along, guys. I'm sorry. This is Imran Ahmad, and damn it, we haven't had enough time to think about this. I didn't think we were going to be this crunched for time at the end of the show. I'm sorry, everyone. But hey, guys, hope all is well. Having recently switched to iPhone, having used Android since Froyo, I'm discovering things that the OS can do that I wasn't expecting. It makes me feel like a kid again. My question is, which recent mobile device or feature gave you that fuzzy feeling, taking you back to feeling like a kid again? Like going to electrical stores and giggling with excitement.
Mm-hmm.
But the great work. Amazing to think you've been podcasting for nearly 3 years. Continue to enjoy listening. Here's to another 3+ years of a great show. Cheers to that, Imran from the UK. P.S. More Dowd, please. That intro still has me laughing. Yeah, me too. Dowd's great. Do you guys have a ready response to this? Because I don't.
Yeah. I'm gonna review it. I'm gonna have my review up this week. It's the ZTE S Pro 2, and it's just Michael was just making fun of me over how excited I was over a digital projector running Android at CES.
Right.
But so here's the thing: you're talking to the oddest geek in the world because he's never owned the game console. I never have.
What?
Not even the first generation Nintendo. Like, all my friends had one, and I was really good at playing them, but when I, you know, when I was young.
Yeah, back in the day. There was only that Magnavox console and the Atari 2600.
I had a Magnavox.
So, arcade games, arcade stores were really, really cheap, really affordable back then, so you really didn't need to play. Why would you buy a game console if you could just go to an arcade and have all those games for really little money? And so I used to be there, and for me, this would be pretty much the first experience where I'm actually having an Android digital projector with one of my favorite Android games and using a Bluetooth controller. Using a Bluetooth controller to play the game. And so I was like, shoot,
all
right.
All the sense in the world. That's solid. That's a good response. I mean, I like
that. It's cool. It's cool. It makes me feel like a kid again.
Steven, what about you?
I got to go with auto stereoscopic displays. I heard such crap about all these smartphones with them, the Evo 3D, and you know how poorly they work. You have to be exactly in the right position. You blink and the display goes to crap. Finally picked up a 3DS, long overdue, a few months back, and my God, it's a 3D screen in your pocket. You don't need glasses for it. This is mind blown in a way it hasn't been. I mean, Virtual Boy back there didn't impress me like this does. It's, you can't reach in. It's not holograms, but my God, the fact that this is possible and is affordable and works as well as it does is just head popping, mind blowing.
I have Michael's response.
Yeah, I know you do because you were there.
The HTC Vive.
I had never
seen Michael cry before, by the way.
It's full of stars.
I had tears in my eyes because I could not convey the experience adequately to you, Jaime. I so want you to experience it. Yeah, the HTC Revive. It's it's not a mobile device. It's a cheating answer, but it's unlike anything I've ever done. And yeah, it made me feel like I was 9 and full of awe all over again. So thank you for that question, Imran. I wish we had more time to answer it. Everyone in the Q&A, thank you so much for your excellent questions and for helping us keep the conversation going. Jaime and Steven, thanks for a really, really, really fun show, and I really appreciate it. And I know we all have stuff to do. So, folks, Jules, thank you once again for all of your hard work keeping us on the clock and going. And that is officially going to do it for this episode of the Pocketnow Weekly Podcast, produced by Jules Wang, about to become a real live human being when he graduates college next week, and tweeting about that experience at Green.0. Also, be sure to find the hosts on the Twitter sphere. Steven's complaining about Android condescension at Steven Schenck, StephenSchenck. Jaime is sharing photos suitable for framing at Jaime_Rivera. That's Jaia_Rivera. And I'm barely keeping my head above water at Captain Two Phones. Captain the number two phones. Pocketnow is also on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and Google+, and it all comes together like fried chicken, boxed potatoes, and frozen corn in 1989's best TV dinner at pocketnow.com. If you enjoy the podcast, be its chariot to the far-flung reaches of the webosphere. Share it with your friends who love mobile technology, and help share it with strangers. And get your chance in to win an LG G3 by leaving us a review on iTunes or wherever podcasts are heard on the web or in the world if you're not interested in the G3. But iTunes.
Specifically iTunes.
Yeah. And remember, you can write to us for a chance to get your questions answered on the air at podcast@pocketnow.com. Thanks to WERS in Boston. Thanks to our sponsor at lynda.com/pocketnow. Most importantly, thanks to you for listening. The Pocketnow Weekly will be back with more mobile tech talk next week.